and they didn't come back?
They were down for the day tomorrow.
Okay, we'll call the Ogoma City Council work session for Monday, March 6th to order. First, we have the agenda in front of us, and unless there's somebody from the council who disagrees, I would ask that we pull items one and two from tonight's agenda, unless somebody would like to keep that on the agenda. Seeing and hearing nothing else, we'll go to city office building security improvements.
Thank you, Mayor. If I could ask you a question about the previous, do you have some direction you want to give us as far as more information you want, or just bring it back at a future meeting?
Council, is there any direction that you'd like to provide to the city administrator? Councilmember Nelson.
I spoke with you earlier. I would like to see the information reviewed by our labor attorney prior to us reviewing it, and also just some direction regarding where we're at with our contracts, what is settled, what isn't settled with that. I also think that there's information missing with regards to what we settled with our previous contracts and some of those with that. So I don't know if anybody else has any.
Anybody else wishes to make a comment?
I would just like to add that I'd like to see more of a historical perspective to the information that's provided and maybe a total cost of the increased benefits, so.
And then the other thing is that Councilmember Maskey and Councilmember Christensen both are not present. Both of them were members of the labor committee in the past, and they would have the historical perspective of everything that was talked about. I know that you have talked to Councilmember Christensen both on, I believe, Thursday and today, and Councilmember Christensen was fine with this moving forward, but I think that it would be good for him to be able to be here and be present to have his opinion stated. Also, Councilmember Maskey was also on that, and so I think it's important that they're here for the historical perspective.
One question. So Councilmember Christensen also said that sending it to the attorney he thought was a waste of our money, that we shouldn't do that. He drafted the agreement last year. I'm kind of caught in the middle if I do or I don't on this one is my question. And maybe during the regular meeting, or wait until it comes back in 2 weeks and...
Yeah, I think you could possibly, Audrey?
That's part of my concern, though, is he drafted the last one last year. There's substantial changes to the document. And I guess that's my concern. It feels more like it's a group again, where we were talking about individuals. And I think that that needs to be addressed in also in relationship to our other contracts. And so I think it has to be reviewed prior to us moving forward with it.
So how do I get around the fact that I have one council person saying you'd kind of like to see that, and one other for sure that said, no, it's a waste of money, and then two others that aren't here without talking about it at a future meeting?
Can I ask another question?
Go ahead.
So he reviewed the document before the rest of us got it? Is that what happened with it, or how did he?
Who's that? Ron?
Yes.
Or Mr. Christensen? No, I talked to him on Friday, and he is not doing too well. As you know, he had surgery. And so we agreed to talk on Monday, and I talked to him for half hour, 45 minutes today. So no, he didn't get it at the same time that you did in your...
So the document was updated over the weekend with additional detail. Did the rest of the council get that information or where?
No, I didn't say it was updated. It was, you all have the exact same document in front of you, and you all received it Thursday via email or Dropbox, and but it has not changed.
I guess if you feel like you need direction, I would ask that we add it onto the agenda then during the meeting and let the council vote on it. I'm concerned that we're bypassing, there's been a lot of work on labor. We've used the labor attorney to settle our contracts and to work with the department heads over the last 5 years, and I think bypassing it now would be critical to what we're doing. So if you think you need the council to vote, I would ask then that this item be put on the agenda to provide you the direction to do that if that's necessary.
Yeah, I would feel better about that, and the right time to do it would be at the beginning of the council meeting for approval of the agenda, if you want to bring that up.
I don't believe we'll have six council members present to add something to the agenda with Councilmember Plowman not here.
Yeah. So it may be just with three of them missing, you may want to, wait for 2 weeks and talk about that.
That was my desire, was to wait for 2 weeks to discuss it in greater detail.
Can I ask one other?
Go ahead.
So if two other people here at the table request that you do that, you would honor that request then?
If it was a motion, yes. It would be a direction to staff to do that, and I would do it, of course.
But you're okay with one person that's not here tonight saying no and accepting that? If two other people here tonight agree that think that needs to be done?
I didn't say that at all. I said that I'm uncomfortable doing it with one person saying yes and another person saying no without direction from the entire council.
Mr. Scott?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, if I could offer a suggestion, I guess. Obviously, there's no formal voting in a work session, but that certainly doesn't prohibit the council members that are present from reaching a consensus on direction to staff or the city attorney. If it is the desire of the council members here that this document be given legal review by Mr. Badden's office or our office, you can certainly discuss that and make the consensus of the council clear, and we will follow that.
Kathy?
Mr. Mayor, I do believe that that would be a good investment to have him review those items. And again, I would like to see some of that come back in a historical perspective also.
Okay, so staff is looking for direction from the council members present as to continue with the discussion in regards to the policy of our department directors and the administrative assistant to the city administrator. Does the council as a whole wish to move that forward this evening and have the discussion, or do they wish that to go to the council meeting? And if I could have each council member express their desire. I believe I've heard from Councilmember Nelson and Councilmember Schwantes, so Councilmember Alvarado.
I would believe that it would be good to have it reviewed by our council, the Labor Council, and bring us up to speed on the historical perspectives and how we got to this point.
Julie?
I'd like to hear from the other two that were critical in the decision-making on the contract. I think they would have some input that would be helpful to help make a decision.
Henrik?
I just need clarification. Are the department heads in their own bargaining group again? Because that was the issue before.
No, they're independent,
right,
individuals.
And the document that was sent out to you is exactly what the council presented, I think it was February of last year, and adopted with the exceptions of the crossed out, like the city clerk was removed in the yellowed area, but the rest of it was what the council approved last year.
But when you're giving 4% across the board adjustment to everyone, it seems like they're in a bargaining group.
Well, it's actually a 2.5% cost of living and a 1.5% range adjustment, but they're not all getting the same thing. In the case of one of the directors, he's moving up somewhat quicker. They're not exactly all the same. And that would be the part, I thought, if we had discussion tonight, that would be the part we'd zero in on and not the rest of it. That was already approved by the council.
Yeah, anytime we approved a contract, we always had Frank Madden go over it to make sure all the dots were, the T's were crossed. So, yeah, I prefer to have the Labor Council look at it.
And Mr. McGuire, for your information, the document was updated on the 4th, and the 4% that Rick talked about is in the document that we have in front of us.
Correct.
So
it's 2.5% of that is cost of living.
That's not what it says. It says ranges will be adjusted each year based on cost of living. In addition, an increase of up to 4% will be given. So cost of living plus 4%.
Correct. In future years, that's the case. But for this year, it's a flat 4%, which includes a 2.5% cost of living. The paragraph before.
Paragraph before talks about the vehicle allowance.
And no, actually, I'm sorry. In the actual car, it's in there. What the recommendation is for this year.
Mr. Mayor.
Kathy.
I think even this conversation just lends itself to say this is complicated. And there's been a lot of history with this, and we have three new council members that don't know what that history is. And our employees, I really believe, are our greatest asset. And we need to make sure that we handle this well so that we don't send a wrong message to them. And it's not that I'm asking for this information or to review it because I don't think that our employees are deserving of being treated well and fairly. It's that I have not sat in this seat long enough to have a good understanding, and I think that there's so much history to it that even if I had been here, it might just be nice to have a good review of how we got where we are today. So I just want to send that message out to our staff that my requesting this information and this action is in no way to be seen by them as a lack of confidence or appreciation in the work that they do. It's more a matter of I really feel that we need to understand it, and I would think my fellow newbies are kind of feeling the same way. There's a lot of history here.
So I think we have all five council members in agreement that it should come back in 2 weeks. And in that interim, what I heard from three people, I guess, is that we should have it also reviewed by council, labor council. And so you and I can discuss that on who we're going to talk to for legal counsel.
Okay.
I guess, Rick, I guess you said Mr. Madden, right?
He's been the attorney since I've been on, so right. I always thought he did a good job.
Okay. Audrey, then I would like to move to the next item on the agenda.
Yeah. I too, am requesting that it be our attorney that has worked with us because he has reviewed this, and I agree with what Councilmember Fagerly says, is that the agreement feels like it has different information in it than when we put it together. So again, this is not to tear apart what's in there, but it is simply a review that it fits with what we're doing with our other contracts. And that we make sure that if we don't have a settled contract, that we're reviewing that in addition to the other things before we set a new precedence.
Okay. Council, I'm ready to move to the next item on the agenda, if everybody else is. Next item on the agenda is city office building security improvements. Mr. McGuire.
Thank you, Mayor. This item is for, well, I guess all work session items are for discussion only, but about a year ago, there was a report done about the security at City Hall, and there were a number of suggestions, and one was to secure the front counter area as you walk in so people can't just simply walk in. And so working with some of the staff, I contacted a local contractor, and I also had actually Councilmember Christensen drew up the plan after I did a couple of relatively crude drawings for him to go by. And maybe we can first look at the three drawings. The first one is the existing one, and the option, both options would take that door out and move it back to the other side of the elevator, as you can see. Option A would put a counter in there with a door. The door would be, you could buzz people through and or go help them at the counter. And then option B is that it's off to the side. I think option A, for a couple of reasons, partly based on cost in the cost estimate for everything that I think is needed for option A is approximately $21,000, and for option B about $30,000. And so if the council feels that this is something worthwhile pursuing, I would get another quote and have them refine the plans a little bit and come back to you. My concern is obviously for the employee safety, but I'm also concerned about any money that we put in that building. It's very substandard building. Does it make sense to put that I mean, how do you weigh the two? You've got two totally different issues. This may be a worthwhile expenditure, even if it's 2-3 years down the road when that building's gone and there's a different location or a new city hall. So I guess I'm just looking for your input on it.
Andre?
Thank you, Mayor. Would you just walk through where staff will be in relationship? So will there be someone at the counter? Will that become a workstation so that someone is physically at the counter to greet people?
At this point, no, they'd be sitting. The closest one would be Deb, which is probably 10 feet or maybe 8 feet away from the counter. And we'd have someone at the other one immediately to the, as you're facing the counter, to the left of the counter. So you'd have two people that when someone came to the counter, they could find out if they're here to meet someone. They would simply buzz them through. If they're looking for a permit or something, then they would go to the counter and help them. If you put it right at the counter itself, I think, first off, you kind of restrict other people from helping. And I would see Randy or some of the people in various different departments actually coming to that counter and helping the customer.
Any other council members have comments? Rick?
What about the tenants in the basement at Minnesota?
I talked with them if they were willing to do some type of a security lock also where they'd have to be buzzed. You'd have to be buzzed in, and they were open to that. And that would help. And then, of course, you also have the problem with the elevator. And we're concerned doing anything with the elevator because it's so old, you probably can't retrofit it, is what I was told. So it's not by far the perfect solution, but it does have that first line of defense, if you will, from people just walking in. There's a number of times where, you know, people are just kind of wandering around, you're back getting a cup of coffee or something, and you say, hi, can I help you, who are you? And they're looking for a certain department, and they just walked right in. Sometimes you have to send them upstairs to finance or something, and this would, in fact, we talked about having, if it was finance, to have the person actually come out and you know, take the person up with them from a safety standpoint. Again, I'm open for suggestions. It's nowhere near a fix all, but it's a relatively inexpensive step in the right direction.
That's what I was going to ask.
Fernando?
Kathy and I were just asking a question. Looking at option A
and B,
you come into the main doors and you come to that first door, do you get buzzed there also? Or
no.
No, that you can come in there, and then if you have access, the door next to the glass, sliding bulletproof glass, that is the door you buzz them in?
Correct.
Okay.
Chief, do you want to make any comments about that? I know that you and I had conversations about this probably 2 years ago, I think was the last time you and I talked about it. But what are your thoughts on this, and what would you think would be the preferred option?
You know, and looking at these the options here, either one would be workable. Right now it is an open area where anybody can walk through, and I've been in the city offices before when customers and citizens have come in and ended up wandering around and, you know, catching them in other hallways where they probably shouldn't be. So from a safety and security standpoint, not only for the people, but of the information and everything in City Hall, you know, either one would be workable. I think option A for a lower cost and would adequately fit the needs.
And then the one has bulletproof glass and the other has double bulletproof glass. So is there a preference over either of those? And is that what some of the cost is? An increase on option number A?
Actually, Mayor, if I could, we're recommending that the bulletproof glass not be in there. It's going to be wide open during the day, so it doesn't serve much of a function, and just go with the shutter, which is a $1,900 deduct.
Okay. And that's $1,900 in each one?
Yes, in either case. If there was a way of, and the only way I could think of doing it would be to put a little hole in the bulletproof glass and pass it on there, but that really, yeah.
That's not customer service.
I know, I don't like that either. So I'd sooner just be able to secure it with pulling down the shutter, I guess they call it.
Monterey.
Thank you, Mayor. Could you just address the elevator? Either way, the elevator is still open. People walk up, push the button. They can come in the back way or go down and...
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yes, they can. And the other possibility would be to lock off the elevator, and when someone needs to use it, wants to use it, you could go out there and unlock it for them. I don't see a good way around that without spending major dollars to redo the, basically put in a new elevator.
My understanding is when you met with the elevator folks, they basically said this elevator is sold. There's really nothing you can do to it. I mean, it's very antiquated.
Correct.
Any other staff have any comments? Audrey?
What if you did the doors so you had to let someone in, put the counter at the first set of doors versus the second set? So that you didn't have, well, the you first, would control the elevator then too?
The first set of doors are more for meetings, for example, that where people do need to take the elevator at night. So we could leave that open but still have it secured at the counter.
Okay.
Again, far from perfect, but it prevents the wandering through City Hall that it takes a second at least, or 5 seconds for people to defeat. I suppose you could jump over the counter, depending how agile you were, but.
Fernando?
One of the, in my place of employment, we have bulletproof glass with a little speaker where you can communicate with the tray. But in addition to that, and I don't know if you can factor that in, we have a conference room that we have secured. We can let somebody in, and that's where you meet them. I don't know if that's something to think about. Maybe not today, maybe tomorrow. It's just, I'm just planting a seed on that. So
we do have the conference room off to the side. That would be a possibility to let people in. And again, it's a stopgap safety measure. And the main thing, you know, should I proceed to the next step and get a second quote, make sure that these are absolutely firm numbers, and he said that he thought they were, get a second quote and bring it back to you, or if you say no, then we're...
I think that, I'm sorry, Kathy?
Well, I was just wondering, how this came to be, and if employees are saying, I really don't feel safe. We've got some situations where it's been a little bit hairy, and we've got particular people that we want to make sure we're controlling the situation. That would be good information for me to know. So what is the history on how this came to be?
Well, I've came upon it in a report that I think the chief called to my attention, and he was party to that, so he may wish to comment. It was, if I recall, it was a little over a year ago that it was completed.
Chief?
Sure, I can comment a little bit on it. You know, part of it was we have had incidents at City Hall. Fortunately, they have been few and far between where irate citizens have come in, whether it be for, you know, our specialty parking permits or parking tickets or other types of permits, or someone's been upset because of, you know, city business, different city business. That's so it has come up during that. What myself and two other officers did, the report that Mr. McGuire is referring to, was kind of a survey of the entire building from the safety perspective on, you know, doors that could be locked, safe areas to go if there would be act of violence there or something like that. So that's the report that he's referring to. And we identified as that front entrance as being a definite liability to everyone in the building, the way it was set up now.
So I look at, you know, if you've got the little speaker hole in the drawer that you slide, that does say to the general public, we don't really want you here. And so there's a point at which you have customer service, and then it's a safety issue. And so I'm just trying to get a sense of, you know, how serious is a safety issue, and that, you know, no disrespect
no.
or anything, but just getting a feel for just enough to make it comfortable, but yet not shutting down city office from the general customers coming in.
And from a safety standpoint for us, too, just simply having a counter there would do wonders for, okay, you know, being able to control access and that type of thing. So personally, I don't feel that the bulletproof glass with the speaker box or anything is anything that's warranted here, but just to need some security upgrades would be very beneficial.
Thank you.
Great.
And I know in the past, you know, I've been at City Hall, and similar to what Mike had stated, you know, you'll be there and all of a sudden, I mean, there's somebody walking in the back, and you know, you go, can I help you? Well, yeah, I'm trying to find, you know, and it might be somebody that works for the county. That's not even a, you know, this is the county building, right? No, you're not in the county building, you're in a city building. So we need to have something to where our employees feel safe, and we have a safe work environment, and particularly with a lot of events that have happened recently in city buildings. I think it's important for us to protect our staff and let them have that additional feeling of safety. Fernando?
I just want to kind of echo that, Mr. Mayor, that our company has done that to make us as associates for the company feel safe and comfortable. And I think they're trying to protect an asset, us. And that's the message I would want to send to our people, that we want to protect them and make sure that they're safe and they know that we have their best interest in mind. It isn't intended to exclude people, but we just want to protect those that work for us. And I guess that's how I would look at it. And I like I said, I was just going to echo what you had to say, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is reimbursement of expenses to David Drone and Associates. This document was drafted after a conversation that I had with the city administrator. And so for the council to consider to reimburse the expenses of $2,999 to David Drone and Associates, the contract clearly spelled out the fact that that David Drone and Associates, if we had our administrator not last past 12 months, in this case that's what happened, they would do the search at no cost. So there is no obligation to the city to approve this. It was just that I felt that we should find out what that cost was and then bring it to the council for their discussion as to whether or not they would want to cover those expenses. And so what they're asking, what he prepared and sent to us was his travel cost, advertising, personality, and intellectual testing and background checks and the costs of those, and that's in the document that you have in front of you. So if this is something that the council would want to consider, I guess at this point we'd have to move it forward to two meetings because we can't act on it because we don't have six council members. But and Mr. McGuire, I don't know if you want anything to add to that.
No, they had given a two-year guarantee on the position. They've I've never heard of that, by the way. Most of them are 1 year, but they did, and the mayor's right, you have no obligation to do it. It was turned out very successful. He put lots of time into it. It's not like he cut corners or anything, so I think it is probably warranted to consider the hard costs for reimbursement.
Kathy?
Just out of curiosity, had we had to pay for the full services, what would the cost of that have been?
I think the first time through it was like 15 or 18,000. I can get that exact number, but in fact, I will if you tell me to bring it back at a future meeting.
Audrey?
It might be helpful to have that, what the contract was and what we paid for expenses, I think, the first time too. Or was it, were the expenses part of the contract the first time?
Okay.
Additional questions, comments?
They're real dollars out of their pocket. So.
I'm sorry,
I was half talking to myself, but they are real dollars out of their pocket for the advertising and the personality and intellectual testing. Those are real dollars to them, so.
So is the council in agreement of moving this to an agenda item for the next meeting, or do we want to let it die in work session?
I think what Kathy has to say, these are real dollars, and I think you put a good effort forward, and I know you know, we could probably take the hard line, but I think the proper way would be to consider it.
Okay. Julie?
What's the purpose then of having the guarantee that they'll come through with another search if it isn't successful? Why would we have that on the books as a guarantee if we're not going to fall back on it?
Yeah, I think the costs, so the soft costs, like what Mike talked about, I mean, he's covering those. So his time, you know, his contact with each of the candidates, you know, coming out and meeting with us, all of that, he's not charging us for any of those soft costs. It's the hard costs that are reflected here. Audrey?
So do we know, did we pay out-of-pocket costs last time, or was it part of the contract?
I think it was part, but I would have to look that up, and I have a note to do that.
So you'd bring that back, right?
Right. If you tell me to bring it back in 2 weeks, I'll have that information and a copy of the contract also.
But, Kathy?
I would just say, I don't have a strong feeling about this one way or another. One way you're sending the message that we're a good community to work with. The other way you're saying, you know what, this wasn't our obligation, and so why would we pay $3,000 more than what we need to pay? So I would just say, if people feel strongly one way or another, if the feeling is that we would not be paying this, I would not want to bring it forward necessarily to the next council meeting.
Yeah, I agree with that as well. Can we kind of poll and see where people are at, Robert, or?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, absolutely. In work sessions, members of the council can express their view on an item like this. If you're in support of it, you can make that known. The only thing you can't do is just take a formal motion and vote.
Okay. So,
business-wise, what's the expectation from the company?
Well, the expectation from the company would be they would not be reimbursed. I mean, like Mr. McGuire said, I mean, they agreed to put a 24-month guarantee. And so they came out, and if you remember the first, I can't remember if you guys were here the first time or not, so I apologize. The first time he came to us, he said, you know, this would be done at no cost. So I think that we're saying, you know, you did have hard costs. You know, your soft costs, yeah, that's the price of doing business, but should the hard costs be looked at or not?
Is it a case that if we wanted to use them again, that they would have a bad taste in their mouth to work with Wilmer because we didn't do these costs? We didn't cover this?
I don't know that answer. Mike, do you have any feel on that?
No, but I could see where it might. But I don't know that. He didn't tell me that. I don't think he told the mayor anything like that.
He said he'd love to work with us, and you know, so he supplied us the hard costs.
Okay, my feeling is this was the guarantee, this was the contract. Why would we pay $3,000?
Okay, thank you. Rick?
They're professionals, they know what they're doing, and they probably put that in there knowing they wouldn't have to do that very often. So did he send us a bill, or you asked him what his?
I asked him. Okay. Yeah, he did not send it on his own.
Yeah, so he wouldn't have.
Correct.
So yep. That was their guarantee, and sorry it didn't work out. So I don't think we can reimburse them anymore.
Okay. Audrey?
I have mixed feelings about it because I think it's been expensive for the city of Wilmer also to go through the process. With that, that's why I was just curious with how to go back and review the contract before we made the decision. I don't think he cut corners with this, but I can agree with what Julie and Rick are saying also. But I'm just curious with if it's a change in their thought process with how the contract was written or if it's just us worrying about it.
The answer to that would be more us worrying about it than him worrying about it. I don't think he was worried about it. Was he, Mike?
No, I don't think so. I mean, he was obviously pleased, and I was with the mayor at the time when we talked that we would consider it. And again, he understood, and I think it was $15,000. So he's basically the $12,000, you know, he understood, didn't even consider. But I think he was kind of pleased when we said at least, you know, give us a cost and we'll bring it before the council.
Kathy? Fernando?
I understand the warranty, you know, that he brought forward. Is there any compromise on this figure? Can we say, hey, can we split it and move on and be done with it? Provide something for him. He did a good job. He kept us focused when he was, you know, mediating and walking us through the process. I think we all enjoyed working with him, or I did anyhow. I'll speak for myself. I thought he did a nice job. And would we go back to him? Would he be available to us? I hope so. But if he takes us wrong, maybe he won't. So in my life, I have to compromise. So I would be willing to maybe split the difference and move on.
So Mr. McGuire, help me with my math here, but I think I've got four that are not willing to move it forward, and one that's willing to move it forward with a negotiated settlement. So I think at that point it dies.
Okay. So,
thank you. Did I see that right?
That's probably a good guess.
Okay. You shook your head no. So, or did that mean you didn't want to comment?
I just didn't have a strong feeling either way. But when you think about it, and it's not an obligation they're expecting, then.
Okay. Julie?
I think it would be nice to be the nice guy and be able to cover these costs, but I just don't think that's fiscally responsible on our part.
Thank you. Okay, next we have, I think that's the direction you needed, Mr. McGuire?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, next we have capital outlay activity, and I'm not sure who's taking that. Are you taking it, Steve? Yeah. Finance Director Steve Okuns.
Mr. Mayor, when the council asked for the capital outlay activity, we went back and reviewed what we had provided to the former finance committee. In reviewing that, it was included in your packet. There's probably more detail than what needs to be, and it can be kept at a staff level. We would probably look at, but it would be entirely up to the council, revising the report to one line items so that you would see what was budgeted, what's been spent to date, and not all the detail of all the different activity. But that's certainly the council's call on whatever format you would like to see it in. Included in the council action request form, we talk about a little bit about 2017 and the timing of expenditures and closing out 2016. And we usually do a first quarter report. We certainly can do it before that time. We've had a couple items that we talked about at a couple of meetings. An example would be the airport, where we had some funding issues and it freed up some dollars. That's one area that we would normally as staff look at for items, capital items that came up outside of the budget. Otherwise, the extra dollars that may be in excess of a capital outlay item is always provided to the mayor in the upcoming budget cycle. I talk a little bit about that as well. If there's an item that hasn't been purchased, again, we talk about that with the mayor in the budget cycle and maybe needs to be reprioritized or something to that effect. But to periodically go out through the year and see $1,000 here or $2,000 there, if it wasn't a major item like the airport, it would kind of get caught up in the budgeting cycle and become available to the mayor to reappropriate. But we're open to changing this format in any way the council wants to see it. This is the activity. It shows a little bit of activity. It shows you that 16 activity, and then it also shows you some items that were budgeted in 15 but not purchased until 16. And there was even a 14 item there. As I talk about in the action request form, the charter allows it for 3 years after the appropriation, but administratively and during the budget cycle, staff's been given the direction to pass on to the department directors if it's a priority, you should buy it in the year it's appropriated or the following year, or it will be looked at again. With that, I'm open to any questions or comments, councilors.
Audrey.
Thank you. I had one question, and that was under the Public Works roof repair. There was money in the 16 budget of $40,000, but it was paid out of the prior year's budget? Was that just an error in budgeting it twice, or what was the reason that we took it out of 15?
I believe that the process budgeted twice, and I see that Public Works Director Christensen isn't here, but I would have to kind of look into that. I know that they were talking about a two-phase type situation, so they may still be doing a second phase. I'm not sure, and I would, I can research that for you and get back to you.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
I know that we've talked about this before, and maybe I'm missing it, but it would be helpful when we're looking at this, but to also have an updated CIP for the year that had what's available to spend, because every time I go look right now, it still has the items that were in there before the mayor pulled items out of the budget. So am I missing it somewhere? Is it somewhere else?
I know that it was revised, and those items were removed from there because you had asked for that before.
Yeah, but is it somewhere else? It's not in the, it's not in our folder under CIP.
I would have to check with the administrator's office. I worked with the administrative assistant to get that out there, and they're the ones who put it into the Dropbox. But I know that it had been revised because that was a concern, and that those are removed. So I will, it should be there.
Because somehow it seems like it should fit in with this report somehow. So we have one place to look to kind of know.
And it will when we put out the first quarter of 17.
It will
show anything that was asked for that was not approved. I also will probably put some notes in here listing the criteria that the staff committee has been given direction from administration on how we rank capital improvements just as we move forward, because we're starting to get into that time frame again. When the new administrator comes in, it will be, I mean, it's a little later than what we would normally start the process for vehicles and capital outlay. The charter requires the mayor to have submit that 3 months prior to when he submits the budget. So the timing on it, that process, the criteria used, and the updated 17 will have all that in the first quarter report.
So the items that were pulled from the mayor's budget this year are not out there right now as future items?
They would have to be resubmitted to the committee what I understand our process has been, to be reconsidered and revalued and prioritized, anything that had been removed.
So again, so if we're looking at what do we have to do next year, there's, I forget how many hundreds of thousands of dollars that were pulled from the CIP this year. Do they almost feel like some of those are going to be more of a priority than the things that are in 18. So I'm concerned that we missed those as we look forward to what needs to be done.
They would be included in the reprioritizing of the 2017, because not only, or I'm excuse me, 2018 requests will have to be resubmitted and all years revised as well. And so anything that was cut in 17, it'll be up to the department directors to address those, and they will be re-ranked based on the criteria that we have, the six categories that we have. If the process stays the same, if the council still wants that process in place.
So an example of that would be the fire truck, where there was $400,000 in this budget that you have in front of you. An additional $200,000 came into this budget. It was carried forward to the next year. That'd be an example of something that was carried forward, correct?
That's correct. One of the other items that was not appropriated or funded in 17 was playground equipment. Right. That was in, just, I mean, and Steve could maybe allude to that. It's in every year, I think. If not, it's in, you know, the majority of the years. That will have to be re-looked at. I'm trying to think of some other things that were removed. But those will all have to be resubmitted to the committee, as will the 18 will be revisited, and there'll always be new ones resubmitted as well, and they'll all go into, is there something that was cut in 17 that can be placed in 18, 19, or 20 in any of the 5 years? It may not just automatically be put into 18. That will be some of the discussion. And when the 17 process was used, we did not have the facility plan. And so the facility plan will throw a big factor in to the capital improvement program. I think we had just received the park plan, and so those items were in the five-year program. So the new plans will all add to it, and we provided a report to the council when we received the facility plan, and we're looking at the local option sales tax on what kind of dollars were we short on the overall capital program. So all those will be taken into consideration in the process, unless directed otherwise by the council.
Mayor? Could you refresh me? You were talking about the airport. What's the airport master plan? What's that $250,000?
What is it?
What's it for?
It's to redo the master plan, which has to be done every 10 years at the airport. And what that plan is used for is the funding request of the Department of Aeronautics. You have to have an updated master plan where it goes through and prioritizes all your capital needs at the airport and the layout and all that. So what you see in the capital improvement plan for the city has been vetted by the aeronautics basically already, because we have to submit that to them too based on the master plan.
What's costing $250,000?
I'm not sure that they have engaged in that at this point, but it looks at the entire airport, the timing of runway extensions. That was the number that was given as an estimate to update the master plan. Hiring consultants, that's basically what it does.
So an example of that, Julie, is when Megan came to us and said, you know, in the budget there was X for the airport, and then they received the grant. Well, without the master plan being updated, we wouldn't be eligible for those grant dollars. And so, and I don't remember what those numbers were off the top of my head, and I don't know if you do or not, but it was a substantial amount of money that we received back. And
okay.
Federal Aeronautics paid for that because we had the master plan done.
Once we had the land release, and the city was, until we received the land release on the airport, was not eligible for federal dollars. And so once the land release was approved at the new airport, we are eligible for an entitlement of $150,000 a year. And so you can only bank up to 4 years of that entitlement. And so the city had built up $600,000 in federal entitlement grant dollars eligible. Once we got the land release, those dollars now we can apply, and that's why the activity that was just approved in the capital improvement, when we were working on it, we didn't have the land release.
Right.
We got the land release after the budget, and that's why there's $147,000 additional city funds available, because we got a bigger chunk on the federal side. But without the master plan update, we wouldn't even be eligible to tap into those federal dollars. And that the master plan is required, I believe, every 10 years to be updated. It is also state eligible costs. I mean, there's
federal and state dollars, right? Yeah. Right. Yeah.
I didn't know if that was a match or if that was something that was reoccurring. Or
that was the total estimated cost, which would include some state and federal dollars.
Does that get you where you need to be? Okay, Audrey?
So on the CIP schedule that you give us, it shows where those dollars are coming from. Would it be helpful for us to understand that? So did we spend the $599,000, or not the $599,000, I'm sorry. Did we spend the money on the airport out of city funds, or did it come out of, I mean, do you understand?
We can certainly put
that
in the report to show the breakdowns. I mean, this report doesn't go into that breakdown detail as the five-year capital improvement program, but we can provide that if the council wants to see that.
Because some of those dollars we're required to spend come from a different location, either different type of funding, so than the actual our cash, correct?
The reclassification of the capital improvement does not happen very often on the airport where we got federal mm-hmm. funding. It was a timing issue. And normally we would notify the council on something that material, that there was a change in funding sources. But if it's helpful to the council that we provide where the sources came from for these expenditures, we certainly can do that, especially for various projects like the airport, waste treatment plant, are two big areas where there are other funding sources available, state and federal monies.
Kathy?
I think early on, Steve had asked for also feedback in regard to this report, if you want the numbers condensed or things like that, and I say thank you for this. I like to see the numbers presented as they are with broken out with the details, because there are some of those things that you can look and go, oh, that honey wagon, the $30,000 that we didn't spend, that's not going to be an expense that we carry forward. But other things like the city, the Rice Park, the splash pad, you know, we're still in process with that, and those funds might be expended. So I like seeing it broken out like this. And if I could even ask for one more thing, and that would be a summary sheet that might say, this is a total for each of those departments, as far as this is a total of what we, what remained as the balance. This is the total of those projects that we assume would move forward. In other words, if it's not the honey wagon where we definitely aren't spending that $30,000, let's leave it in there. And then we have an idea of what that actual carryover is for underspent items for the year. Does that make sense?
We can provide that as a section of the report, or you said a summary?
Yeah, it could just be a summary sheet that you go with it. I'm assuming that this is a computer generated, and so it's nice to not have to create a whole new spreadsheet to add those items on. So just a quick summary, but then we'd have a little bit better feel of how much we have to carry forward and cash we would have to work with.
I agree, because then that's where I'm at with, do we have a place, like back at the, is there a place that we're spending that $250,000? What's that for? Are we going to be using it?
And that's kind of speaks to the timing and the issue that we have. We provide that information to the mayor, you know, for the items that have been spent. When we start the budget process, we know that those items have been bought, and so those dollars really are available. And just timing-wise, historically, we provide that to the mayor so that he can appropriate them or do that in the 18 budget cycle. Those items that would not have been purchased yet or may not get purchased before the end of the year would not be provided to him and would show that it's still tied or appropriated for those reasons. But we can do a summary like that, certainly. It may affect if the council, you know, like I mentioned earlier, if you look at $1,000 here or $2,000 there, you know, not a big item, but it may be when we get into it, but if you have larger items. But that's just the process that, so it's not like the dollars just sit there. When we know that the items have been purchased, the available dollars that are left are provided to the mayor as carryover dollars and are appropriated in the following budget cycle.
Yep. And historically, those numbers are about $1 million a year, right?
They have been not that much carryover, are you asking now? Not normally that much carryover. Most of the items, and especially now that the departments have been given the direction that they have to spend it in the current year or the following year instead of a three-year gap, those numbers are going down. So most of them.
As an example, about how much are they?
This will be the second year that we'll be into that. So $1 million carryover is the total carryover for the general operating and capital.
Correct.
The capital portion is somewhat less because those are anywhere from 100 to 200,000.
Okay, thank you. Does that help? Questions? Okay, thank you. Next we have the auditorium gun range usage report. Mr. Brisendine, are you doing that or who's doing that? Well, Steve, you're doing that one too. And I think this was a request of the council to have a breakdown of the numbers. And so I think, hold on, let me go back to item number 5. Do we need to take anything forward to the next council meeting on item number 5, or was having that update at the work session, is that good enough? I don't see an action item there, so I don't see a reason to move forward. Okay. Next, we have the auditorium gun range usage report. Mr. Okuns.
Again, Mr. Mayor, we were asked to provide some revenues. We gave some rough numbers at the previous meeting. The auditorium and gun range historically have not been budgeted separately, not saying that it can't be. The city a number of years ago used to, give you an example, used to budget for tree removal, snow removal, used to have a number of different areas that we had cost centers for public works. It was determined at during the budgeting cycle and past administrations and mayors that there was no need to know that, because if you take a year like this year, the snow removal budget would have historically been under budget, and the tree removal budget would have been over, because they're reallocating their time because of the open winter. And so there's a lot of areas where it's really kind of directed by the council on how you want cost tracked and accounted for. And so the auditorium, until the situation with the gun range, basically was the auditorium, and there was no cost breakout of that. We certainly can do that. We didn't have really kind of an idea yet. This is the first full year, 16 is the first full year of operation since the repair or the renovation of the gun range. And so utility costs are up. The revenues that you see on the committee action form there, and Mr. Brisendine can speak to it a little bit too. These are the numbers that pre-audited at the end of 16 of $9,570, of which $7,000 was for the private range use, and expenditures of $60,000 plus. That goes to the percentage that we kind of talked about a little bit at a previous meeting. Also included in your packet, you'll see that there is a historical classification of that building. That was based on the 2014 master plan of all the city's buildings, and included were the monthly or the year-end reports to substantiate the $60,000 number and the $9,570. With that, maybe Mr. Brisendine can clarify the range fees.
Yeah, as Mr. Olkin said, the range fees are through last year, there were some changes. We've had some payments come in late from some vendors, so mostly the conceal and carry classes. We just posted revenues last week of about $2,400 that were actually 2016 revenues. So Steve will, in his reconciliation of the year end, which he's moving into now with the auditing process, so the numbers are a little bit stronger than this. On a weekly basis, I would say we're averaging about $300 from the open shooting revenue. So that has been Tuesday, Thursday nights, and in addition, they've added some Friday afternoon shooting as well. So on average, it is around $300 that we take in. The range masters do have a breakdown of resident and non-resident. That report did not get to my desk today like we had hoped it was going to, but off the top of their head, they said it was about a 50-50 split between residents and non-residents that use the range. As Steve said, we have not historically broke out expenses, but once we started occurring more continuous cost, we did direct Sean's staff to start creating a spreadsheet for us so that we would know more of the expenses related to the gun range versus the auditorium as a whole. So the products that are being used in the gun range will now have a better handle on that, and I would guess that we've started that somewhere in the neighborhood the 1st of February of this year. The thing that is not on there is the cleaning expenses. We don't allocate custodian time to this facility at all, right, Steve? It's not in the auditorium budget. So Chris Simon spends a fair amount of time in the whole facility, and then we've got our other two custodians, Jeff and Mark, going over there once a month, roughly. Each one of them are between the three of them, they're all cleaning it on a weekly basis, one of them, and then once a month, all three of them go over there and do a more thorough cleaning of that facility.
So, and in addition, the Tuesday, Thursday evening, we also have a facility staff member from a community ed and rec employment standpoint that is there at that facility as well. So those are added expenses that we've had in the past. Those are explanations of estimated revenues, and we will have more cost accounting with that facility moving forward.
Just a question on the $2,400. Was that money that was in your possession, or is that money that they brought to you after kind of a lot of this stuff started coming up?
Yeah, we invoice. I don't know that we've invoiced as often as we should, but we've created a new process for invoicing the use of that facility. It was just an invoice that had not, multiple invoices that had not been paid for last year. Came in with one check and got caught up is what happened.
Okay, thank you. Council questions? Julie?
Have we had to pay any specialized cleaning services?
We did this fall when we cleaned it for the first time since it had reopened. We anticipate having that service come out at least annually. Sean's not here right now, but we had talked about potentially twice a year. That took place in November this past year. So the range closes, open shooting at the range closes the end of April. So our anticipation was to bring that firm back in May to get it cleaned again and then tested again as well. So our hope is to do that twice a year.
And what did that cost?
A lot of money. We cleaned it, tested it. It was still high. Cleaned it, tested it. It was still high. Cleaned it, tested it, and it got into the allowable standard that the lead testing firm recommends for public facilities. I think we've made some changes to the facility that will allow us to stay on top of it better. Due to Frank's assistance, the custodial schedule for cleaning that facility is stronger now, so we don't anticipate that issue happening again. I believe that was over $12,000 between the testing and cleaning of the facility in November.
Per time or total?
That was for the three times that they came out. So we hopefully the processes that are in place will eliminate much of that cost in the future. I think we had gotten estimates of somewhere in the 2,200 range for them to come out annually to test that, clean it and test it.
Okay. Just a little discussion. Audrey?
So are those figures in that 60,000? Figure? Yes, Steve is saying yeah.
I would believe so. Yeah, not broke out, but yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah, because that would have been a November invoice. Yeah.
So, I know when we were reopening the range, you went through and did an estimate of what the cost would be to try to come up with rates, and we did not follow that recommended rate structure that I think you had brought forward. So, do we have the things in there like the special insurance that we need to have, or some, are they being allocated, or do we need to do a different type of allocation to reflect those costs too?
I'm not aware of any insurance costs, but insurance would not be allocated to this facility at this time either.
The only insurance that I would know would be the building, unless Judy could allude anything different as far as if there's a special insurance because of the range. But the building's insurance, if it's based on having a gun range in it, I don't deal with that, but the building's insurance is charged to the auditorium. I don't know if there's an allocation or an extra charge or an increase in the cost due to the gun range being in there. I'm not sure.
I thought we had to check with the League of Minnesota on liability insurance or something with that when we were looking at it.
That'd have been Kevin dealing with that back then, and I don't know that Judy's got that information at this point. I don't recall that, Audrey, but that
okay.
Very well.
I could be wrong.
Mike, can you check on that for us?
Yes.
Thank you.
The other question I'm just curious about, because I know with the community center, we allocate staff, we allocate custodians, we allocate those kinds of things, but what you're saying is we don't do that in the auditorium building?
Correct.
Is there a reason that we don't? Just I'm just curious. If we're passing judgment and we're raising rates at the community center and we're raising rates at the aquatic center, you know, how do we, I mean, what other income do we have? I know there's line items here with the rent that we get from the school. And, I mean, I'm not quite sure what the right answer is to this because I don't want it to be penalizing, but it seems like if we're passing judgments on other things we do, whether it's the Civic Center or any of them, why aren't we doing the same thing on this building?
When we reopened the facility, we did allocate the extra staff that would be there. So building supervisors. Frank put together a schedule for the cleaning of that facility, so I think we've got an ability to track the custodian time that is there, and then to be able to allocate dollars to that, we would have a record of that. It isn't in the budget that way right now, but it doesn't say that we could not do that once we have a track record of what the time will be for that those three custodians put into that facility.
Are some of those city staff and some of those community ed and rec staff?
All three of them are city staff. The building supervisors are community ed and rec staff that are on the city portion of our operation.
So we allocate those?
Those dollars are allocated in the budget. When
to this?
We reopened, that was revenue that were expenses that were added into the budget for that facility.
Another question that I was asked is the usage down since it's reopened? Are they going other places to do their classes and to do, or is the usage just same as it was before?
I think some of them, when the building closed down, did go other places for classroom, and I think that might still be happening to a small degree. I think there's 7 vendors currently using that facility, and it's used quite often. So I don't think we lost any business. I would say that we've actually picked up business since we reopened.
Okay, thank you.
Kathy?
Just from my understanding, Steve, who else is all in that building? Who else uses a space? Do we have any offices over there that have people in them? Or?
No, we don't office anybody out of there any longer. We've got our yellow bike program is manned. We've got fix-it stations in the second floor of the facility that we've got volunteers that are putting bikes together for us in the second floor. We've got all the other rec programs that take place there. There's men's and women's tennis. There's been pickleball there in the past. There's boxing. There's the basketball. Cardets have been holding practices there for the last 5 or 6 years, roughly. We've run middle school basketball games. We've run 9th grade basketball games, and then all the adult leagues. So it's still a very well-utilized gym floor, as well as the range and the activities that take place with the range. Those are the main usages of it. The stage gets used for some fitness and recreation classes. And then, like I said, the boxers still use the stage of that facility as well. Some of the conceal and carry staff vendors also have some self-defense classes, so they use the stage area for some of those classes as well.
Good. Thank you.
Hey, Audrey.
So the breakout that we got shows like volleyball entry fees, soccer entry fees. So this isn't really referencing the rental of the building. So where does that revenue go, or how does that work?
Those are other program revenues that we receive through the Community Education Rec. That sheet was just included as a general where the auditorium rental fees are listed. There's really only 2 line items, the gun range fees on the report. We included the entire report because that's what we provide monthly to the various departments.
So from a revenue standpoint, the program pieces for that facility, the revenues all get put into programs. We don't have necessarily a rental for that facility. We do have a rental rate for it if somebody does decide to rent the gym or something. That hasn't happened recently.
Example would be like the Noon basketball that he's referring to. You know, they have a Noon basketball. Those fees aren't shown as revenue for the auditorium or the gun range, but they're shown as
adult basketball code.
So you don't really have cost centers broke out for each?
Each program that's held there, we don't at the present time, but we certainly could.
Be the same with the softball fields. All those revenues just go into a softball code. you know, soccer, same thing.
So it kind of crosses the line between city and community ed and rec, right? As far as budgets,
income and expense? Historically, there's a pretty defined split as to what's recreation and what's community education. And programs get put into those areas, and we've stayed with majority of historical past on what programs belong to what entity. New programs are decided as to where it makes sense in a budget for them to go. Indoor soccer in the wintertime is held at Kennedy, so that typically gets run through a city code. In the summertime, they move outside and play on city fields, so that gets put in the city's revenue code in the summertime.
And the process that's used presently is that the school collects those fees through the Community Education and Recreation Office, and they provide a monthly reconciliation of all the program revenues and the expenditures to our office, and then we record them, and every 3 months or so we reconcile, and either the school sends us a check or we send them a check, depending on what the revenues are compared to the expenditures.
Okay. Steve, one of the questions that I had from one of the users of the gun range was that we charge by the half hour for the gun range, and other places charge by the full day. Have you explored that at all with the users?
Mayor, we charge by the half hour for open shooting, and that's typical of the ranges that I've done any research with. We do have an all-day rate for those that want to rent, and that's what the conceal and carry vendors use. They rent it. Actually, it's an hourly rate. I suppose we could put it into a day rate as well. We haven't done that, but they rent it by the hour. So there's an hourly rate as well as a half-hour rate for the open shooting.
Okay. And so let me walk down that path just a little ways. So if you had a instructor coming in teaching a student, 19 students as an example, and you did what they were talking to me about doing a full-day rate, you would charge that per student, not per the classroom, in theory. So really charging by the
lanes of that facility, we would charge for the range itself. So there'd be an hourly rate for the range. We wouldn't charge by the student. They charge by the student. We've got an hourly rate that they would use. We don't care if there's 5 students or 50 students in there. It'd be up to them on how long they would need that facility. So we charge by the hour for when anybody's going to use that whole facility themselves.
Okay. So it is open if someone wants to rent it.
Oh, yeah.
They could just take and come in and say, we want to rent it for the full day, and we'll pay you X for the full day.
Yep, and there just has to be a range master site for that. And that's true with every other public facility that we've researched as well.
Thank you. Additional questions? Rick?
Just one question. They used to have a screen in the classroom area. It's gone now, and they just have a 4x4 white cardboard thing. Are you putting the screen back up, or?
We mounted a whiteboard that has met their needs. They've also got a flat screen TV for the DVD player that they use. I don't know that they project much anymore, Rick. I think most of what they do is on the TV screen. So I have not been asked to put a screen back in there.
That was just there a month ago, and it was a 4x4 cardboard thing on a table against the wall.
Yeah, a piece of whiteboard. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's, you know, we have not been asked to put a screen back up.
Well, the instructor complained about it, so.
Yeah.
Just asking.
Yep.
Thanks. Okay. Next, we have the agricultural land exemption. Steve, I don't know if you just drew the lucky star or Mike, you were sitting right next to Mike, and Mike said, Steve, take care of this, but boy, you've had a ton of them here, so keep rolling, I guess.
Mr. Mayor, this item was directed to staff from prior councils, there was some concern about the agricultural land exemption as it relates to special assessments. The city has a policy that if there is a street past a parcel that is 5 acres or more, that's an agricultural nature and They are using it as such that they can apply to the city for an exemption. They have to do that every year. They have to renew their application and exemption for those special assessments. The way the city funds those costs are the Community Investment Fund has to kind of buy that receivable. One of the reasons discussed when this policy was first enacted was the requirement that the city would have to prove benefit to the property or increased value for those improvements. And I believe that's why this policy came about. It is a good tool to use to track costs that were incurred against a parcel or a street or water and sewer. And if that parcel is ever platted or developed or brought into the city, if it happens to be on the fringe, the engineering department with our office compares the current costs against the cost of the improvements of when they were installed to determine which is higher, and that is what's charged to the properties for a tapping fee to access those services. And so in that respect, it has worked well for the city. At a minimum, we recover the cost of the improvements that are against the property, and at best, we sometimes charge more. An example would be the current school property that was developed. That was a large agricultural exempt piece of property. And when the improvement costs to install the improvements currently were calculated, they were substantially more than what the costs were when they were originally made available to the properties. On the sale of the property owner paid the revised upward costs. So this was a council request that we relook at this part of the assessment policy, and our recommendation would be to leave it. It seems to work well for the city.
And I believe that this council member is no longer serving when this question came up. And so what staff is recommending is we leave it the way it is, no changes. Council, questions on that? Okay, and so if there's no changes, we don't need to bring it to the next agenda.
Right. Item, so.
Okay. I don't have anything else on the work session that's in front of us. So with that, we'll adjourn until the council meeting starts at 7 o'clock.